It is the way it's been on the morning and a natural thing. It is the way it's been on the morning and a natural thing. It is the way we come to the mic sound within the champion sound.
Okay, Lamborghini Mercy. Yo, chick, she's so thirsty.
Tina once again from ShortMeTina.com with my daily recap. Today is Monday. I hope you had an awesome and great weekend. What did I do this weekend? Well, before I relay what I did this weekend, definitely comment in the comment section and let me know what you did this weekend. I had a busy weekend. I went to a gender reveal. I played a little bit of bingo, but not just any ordinary bingo. This is drag bingo, which takes it to a whole nother level. I had dinner with some friends, spent some time with my family, my daughter. So all in all, a busy weekend, but it was very productive. And overall, I had a good time. So let me know what you did this weekend. I hope your weekend was just as enjoyable as mine. Before we get underway, if you are a new trader and this is your very first time tuning in, I want to thank you for finding us. And I hope you stick with us. If you are returning and you listen to us day in and day out, you know what I'm gonna say. You are the bloodline here. You are our lifeline. And I want to say thank you once again from the bottom of my heart for tuning in every single day. So let's just get underway with the S&P 500, the SPY right now. What you're looking at is a daily chart dating back to 2017. And remember the analysis that I've done previously. I said we need to make sure, let's see how we close out the month of March. Let's see how we open up in April. And we opened up with April with an extreme bang. We actually closed out the month of March. Not great, but not bad either, right? So we closed March at 282.84. That's incorrect. We closed March 282.48, which is slightly above that resistance of 280 to 282. Today we gapped up. We gapped up, opened up at 284.70, running right out the gates. Closed at 285.74, up about 1% on the day, decent volume. So like I indicated before, a cue to go along would be that break above the most recent high of 285.18. We did that today. Do I expect it to be smooth sailing from here? Absolutely not. For me, best case scenario, and I know everyone is bullish right now, I'm personally not. Best case scenario would be for the SPY to pull back to that breakout point of around 280 to 282, that resistance level. If we can pull back there and not dip too much lower, then I think we are gearing up for that next run to retest all-time highs. Obviously, in the market, you have to have the ability to change your mind if things don't work out, right? So if the SPY cannot hold and sustain that 280 to 282 level and it dips substantially below, then that means that it was a fake out and the breakout is not going to happen as I suspect. But so far, so good. I'm actually being very optimistic here. Again, we came running out the gates for April up about 1.15%, close to 285.74. I don't know what else to say. I mean, it's very bullish price action in my opinion. What else do we have? All right, so the SPY wasn't the only thing that rallied today. The IWM up about 1% daily chart. We closed at 154.72, very far off of December lows, hence why I'm actually happy in our decision to buy as the market sold off, because we were able to capitalize off of this move. Again, folks who were fearful getting in, you're not going to make money being fearful in the stock market. Point blank, that is it. So if you have fear, find a way to get over that fear, because the market will punish you. The market will not give money to folks that are fearful of the market. You have to know how to operate within it. You have to know how to play the game. So when most folks were really panicking here, granted, we were short the SPY around this area, but when folks were panicking, we also were smart enough to start buying the markets in increments. And because of that, we were able to capitalize once again off of this huge rally. Anyway, we're not out the woods as of yet, sitting here at 154.72. We're still under resistance of 158 to 160. But again, if everything unfolds the way I suspect and I want it to, we should be above that 158 to 160 mark at any point. So that's what I'm paying attention to for the IWM. What else? And then we have ticker BMY daily chart. So we don't talk to, or I have not spoken much about our short positions, but this one actually hit our initial target most recently when it went as low as around 45 on Friday in pre-market, sitting here at 47.09. It has rebounded since, but if you take a long, and you won't see it on this chart. This chart only goes back to April of 2018, but if you plug in ticker BMY in your charting software and you take a longer term view, I'm talking about going out to like 2016, you will see that BMY is in a long, well, if you want to consider 2 year long term, we can call it intermediate or long term. It is in a 2 year decline, and so we were capitalizing off of that move, right? Sometimes it's best to trade in the direction of the overall trend, right? There might be, if you look here, and just pardon, there's construction going on once again, it's so freaking annoying, but there, if you look at the shorter term trend, right, January of 2019, this is a shorter term uptrend, but we're not paying attention to that, right? We want to trade in the direction of the longer term trend, and the longer term trend is the stock being in a decline. So again, it was featured in our watch list, our Sunday watch list that we release every Sunday for free. If you go to shortmeetina.com and click on trading watch list, you'll see BMY there, a premium member winner. Again, capitalize off of this on the short side. I think it's great to know how to both long and short. It's taken me a while to perfect, because there's no quite perfection in the market, but it's taken me quite some time to hone in on both those skills. But being able to short, definitely, I think it's a must-have in every trader's repertoire, because the markets will not always go up. You're going to have times where things are depressed, like we saw back in October, and you want to be able to capitalize off of those moves. I don't know about you, but I don't like to feel like I'm helpless in a situation, and only knowing how to go long when the market is in a decline, or when an individual stock is showing weakness, for me, I would feel helpless. So knowing how to short, it's good. We ended up shorting this. It worked out, sitting here at 47.09. It's still showing weakness for me. So what I'm going to be paying attention to, and you should too, if you're looking to short this, and I'm not saying to, that's on you, but pay attention to 46. If it breaks that, I think things can spiral a little bit quickly. What else do we have? And so we have now ticker Lyft, LYFT, hourly chart. So the stock gapped down today. We closed on Friday at 78.28. We opened up today at 74.95. That should have told you that things were not going to be good. So we're off about 12%, closed at 69.49. So is it time to go long? I personally wouldn't go long at this point. If you're looking for a price point to pay attention to now, on Friday it was 80. I indicated anything below 80, things get bullish, rather bearish. Anything above 80, things get bullish. So price point going into tomorrow and further on, I would be paying attention to around that 69 level, right? 68, 69. Similarly, anything above 68, 69, you have a chance of actually filling this gap here, running back to 80. Anything below 68, 69, and things might spiral more. What else? And then we have ticker LEVI, daily chart, another stock that IPO'd just a few short days ago. So more selling. I mean, not on volume here, but huge range, right? So the high today was 24.19. The low today was 22.60. We closed at 22.71. So similar to Lyft, LYFT, was a brutal day today for both these stocks that recently IPO'd. You know what I'm going to say, considering we closed so low, or so close to the low of the day, I'm expecting selling into tomorrow. We're off about 3.5%. So pay attention to 22.60. If we dip below there, things might spiral out of control. Levi, for me, not a buy at this point. What else? And then we have NIO, ticker NIO, daily chart, dating back to when the stock IPO'd as well. A lot of fresh stocks on the market. Anyway, so back in mid-March, NIO broke down. It broke support of around $6, and it's had a hard time actually getting back above those levels. Today, we closed at 521. Granted, we're up about 2% in the last 4 days. We've been in a slight uptrend. But again, for me, it has to get above and hold 6 for me to become bullish on the stock. Right now, sitting here at 521, I'm not sold. It has to prove itself to me. But I still think it has the potential to do great things, granted, or providing that it actually gets above this support level here. Now resistance of $6. So that's what I'm watching for. That's what I'm paying attention to. What else do we have? And then we have ticker JD Daily Chart, another stock that we took in the premium member community that worked in our favor. And I believe it was the video that I did on Friday. I just talked about a lot of lessons and I used JD as an example, at least I think I did, where, you know, the money's really is made in the sitting, right? Not in the active trading, believe it or not. It's something that I learned many years into trading. Like, I thought, you know, the best thing for you to do was to take those quick wins. They compound, you know, those quick 2-3% wins, and that's good. That's fine. If that's your strategy and you're comfortable with that and it's making you money, that's good, because the objective is to make money. But when you want to make those sort of, I don't want to say not life-changing, but when you want to make those sorts of money that really starts to affect your bottom line, perhaps even life-changing, you have to be able to hold on to your winners, right? So we got into this stock when it hit support, right? It held here, 19 held here. So we kind of banked on the fact that it was going to hold again, third time's a charm, right? And so we went long around 1920. Now, granted, our initial target was hit a while back, but I always tell folks, yeah, you can take those quick wins, that quick 9-10% move, but if you really want to affect your bottom line, do your best to tie your hands and literally hold on to the stocks that are showing you a profit. If you have no reason to sell, why are you selling? So for the folks who took their profits and ran when it hit our initial target around 9 to 10% in, great, did they make money? Absolutely, they made money. But for the folks who said, well, you know what, I'm gonna hold this to see how far it goes, sitting here at 31.26, they have almost, not quite double yet, although I believe it's going to get there. They're up about, what is it, 50% from the initial buy zone of around $19-$20. That's a huge move. That's a bigger move. Imagine gaining 10%, getting a 10% return versus getting a 50% return. At any rate, I've been very bullish on JD. If you are a recurring listener, you listen to my channel day in and day out, you know that I've been bullish since the stock was back here. I've been doing analysis on this since like December or January when it was trading at around 22. I said, everyone, put JD on your radar. If you go to shortmetina.com, it's been on our trading watch list for so long. No excuse. Really, there is none. So sitting here at 31.26, huge move. We don't know what tomorrow holds, but it is acting bullish, right? It's acting bullish. We've had our pullbacks, but it's been in a nice uptrend since December. Like I indicated before, I think we run into resistance around 35. I wouldn't say smooth sailing, but I'm expecting this stock to hit 35. If the overall markets continue to charge like it did today, definitely expect this to hit 35 within April. So I like it so far. I have no reasons to be bearish at this point. Up about 3.6%, close at 31.26, very far off of that 19.20 initial entry zone of ours in our premium member community. Like this trade. This is the stuff things are made of. Can you imagine? Consider how many losing trade this 50% win will pay for, right? Because we have losers. I have losers. Although, I would say we've only been stopped out of, probably two trades for the entire first quarter, dating back to January. I think we've only been stopped out of about two or three trades, which is enormous, right? Like I indicated before, and I'm going to stop rambling, but that's possible because I trade within my scope of competency, right? I don't really veer out of that. I know what I know, and I trade what I know. Still like JD, would be great to see 35. This is a stock I plan on holding for a very long time. What else? And then we have ticker EVOP Daily Chart, another premium member winner. We got into this at the lower end, I want to say around 21, 22, somewhere around there. Don't quote me. Most recently, we went as high as 29.63. Similar to JD, I did say that this is a stock I can see in the 30s, potentially a double. We closed at 29.23, right? We broke out of this channel most recently towards the ending of March. Today, it looks like there's going to be some sort of offering. It's off. The last I checked, it was off about 5% in after hours. I saw a print in the 27s. Now, this is where holding becomes a little bit difficult. So I'm going to pose a question to you. And if you know the answer, please comment in the comment section. There's no right or wrong answer. This just speaks more to you as a trader and your own individual temperament. So Let's say you were subscribed to the premium member community, and you should. I don't know why. You'd learn so much, right? You'd be actually trading with someone who's been in the game for a long time. You can learn a lot. But if you're not a part of the premium member community, it is what it is. But let's say that you were, and you got this trade idea, and you were able to get into this trade in January with a nice, sweet entry zone of around, let's say, $22, right? Where would you have let go of the trade? Right? Would you have let go of the trade when it hit 23? You're up about $1 for every share owned. How about 24? You're up now $2. What about 26? You're up now about $4. When it got to 28, would you have let go of your trade? You're up about $6 for every share owned. What about when it went to 29? You're now up about $7 for each share owned. Would you let go of your trade? Right. Now, say you decided to hold on to your trade. Now, in after hours, you see the offering. The stock is off about 5 or 6%. We're trading at around $27. So whereas last week, you're sitting here nice, up about $7 for each share owned. Today, you look at your account, and you're still up, right? Because we got in around 22, so you're still up. But now, your account is less from when you looked at it on Friday, at least with this particular trade, because now it's off about $2 or $3 from the high we experienced last week. So the question is, well, two questions. Where would you have let go of your trade had you gotten in around 22? Would you have let go at 23, 24, 25, so on and so forth? Say, for example, you were really strong and you know, what I'm saying to you resonates. You hold on to that trade. You know, last week you're all happy. You're like, oh, great, it's at 29.63. 13 is at 30s around the corner. Oh, man, I'm going to be rich. 30s around the corner. And then, boom. Today and after hours, there's an offering. Stock is trading at around 27. You're down a little bit. You're getting nervous. Will you let go of the trade? No right or wrong answer. Comment in the comment section. Let me know what you would do. It's what you would. So I don't want to. So how do I want to frame this? How you react, right, or how you would react, obviously would have a bearings on your trading performance, not just with this stock, but just in general, how you react when things like this happen. So I'm curious to know how you would personally react to such a scenario, right? But I'm still bullish on ticker EVOP despite it being down in after hours. What else do we have? So we're back at it with ticker BPMX daily chart. So again, if you've been paying attention or if you've been listening to my analysis for a while, you know what I'm going to say, or you know what I'm going to So I've indicated the longer, and you can go back and look at any of my videos, and this is why, it's part of the reason why I do daily videos. So for folks to get an understanding of how I analyze charts and to literally monitor in real time the things that I say, it's up, it's, you know, it's on the internet, and it is visible for everyone to see. I'm opening up myself, right? There's that vulnerability, that transparency. I'm opening up myself for folks who actually sit there and judge me, and I'm okay with that, right? I stand by my method. I stand by my years in the market. I stand by what I see in the charts, and I believe I have, and this is not like any sort of bragging or any sort of grandiose type of thinking, but I do believe I have a really deep level of understanding when it comes to the stock market, and not just, oh, looking at candles here and there, but like when I see price action and patterns, like it really does tell me emotionally, you know, what folks are thinking about a particular stock. And so bringing it back to BPMX, because you know I like to go off all the time, like I just ramble, right? I'm just like a talker. Actually, whatever. Some say, you know, I say I'm not a talker. A lot of people say that I talk too damn much, but I know, I think I'm actually a very introspective, kind of reserved introvert. Yeah, I think I'm an introvert. I don't know. Anyway, BPMX, daily chart. So I've been saying for a while, right, the longer or the more frequently a stock revisits a certain level, the likelihood of that breaking increases. And so the fact that BPMX kept hitting up against that 9 cents wall, right, kept hitting it, I said, it's a matter of time before it breaks. And it kind of, or the stock tried to throw some of us off, right, in mid-March when it had this 2 to 3 day gap up that did not faze me. I said, well, good, great gap up. Let's see if it sustains that move. It couldn't sustain that move because there's no real power behind the stock right now. Can things change tomorrow, next month? Absolutely. Things can change in the fundamental of the company and, people might become more bullish. Right now, the bulls are, I want to say, they do not have faith in the stock, and you can see it here. So eventually, last week, I don't think I covered it last week, but eventually that 9 cents mark broke. We went as low as 7 cents. And what did I say? I said, if it breaks 9, chances are we're going to revisit 5 cents. We didn't get to 5. It went to 7. Some buyers stepped in, kind of held it up. But sitting here at 8 cents, if we drift lower and touch 7 cents, like I've been saying since around January or February, we might revisit December lows of 5 cents. And if you're really brave and you want to possibly go long at that time or at that point, you might be able to get a bounce. We can call that a double bottom. What else? All right. And then we're going to round it out. Let's round it out with ticker WFT daily chart. Let's focus in on price action that began in November 2018. The stock broke out, finally broke above resistance, let's say towards the ending of January. We can call that resistance level like around 60 cents. That 60 cents level, once resistance, is now support. And it's relatively fairly strong, right? We retested it on February 28th. Stock went as low as 60 cents. It bounced. It held that. A few days later, the bears tried again to break that level. It went as low as 59 cents. It held. So for me, sitting here at 76 cents, up north of 10% on the day, as long as it can stay above 60 cents, I am bullish. And it hitting $1 increases. So still potential upside sitting here at 76 cents, so long as it does what? Remain above 60 cents. So let's wrap it and round it out there. Tina, once again, from ShortMeTina.com. If you enjoyed any portion of this video, I would like for you to do 3 things for me. 1, comment in this comment section. I ask you tons of things. I ask you your take on EVOP. What would you do? Would you hold? Would you sell? I'm also asking, are you in any of the stocks that I listed here? How is it working out for you? I also ask, because I'm extremely nosy, how was your weekend? What did you do? Comment in the comment section. Engage. Say hi. That's great. I've noticed a real uptick in the comments, and I am loving it, right? Folks are talking. I'm getting to know you guys. Others are getting to know you. It's just great. It's a community. It's all love. That's the first thing. The second thing is, if you want more videos like the one that I did today, and you don't want to miss anything, then just head on over to our YouTube channel at ShortMeTina and hit that subscribe button. Turn on notifications. I do video Monday to Friday. Every time the market is open, you can expect a video. If you're subscribed and you hit notifications, guess what? When I upload a video, you will never miss it, right? I think it's a win-win for you. Win-win. And lastly, if you want more value, then head on over to ShortMeTina.com. Sign up. Become a member.
Let the suicide doors up. I threw suicides on the tour bus. I threw suicides on the private jet. You know what that mean, I'm fly to death. I step in Def Jam building like I'm the shit. Tell them give me 50 million or I'ma quit. Most rappers taste level ain't at my waist level. Turn up the bass till it's up in your face level. Don't do no press, but I get the most press, kid. Plus yo, my bitch make your bitch look like pressure.